Mark.com.
Welcome to Peter and Roughie's Football Show, sponsored by Arnold Clark. I'm Peter Martin, delighted to have your company. Alan Rough, Tam Cowan and Stevie Naismith are here with me. League Cup, quarterfinals, Scottish Cup to talk about. Lots of football issues emerging today. Possible trouble for clubs financially if they don't get an injection of cash. Lots of things to discuss. But we start today's programme with, I think, something that's only right and proper and fair to do. I offer an apology. An unreserved apology to Roughie for laughing him out of town last night alongside my compadre Charlie Adam. We looked at you, we thought, there he is, the usual joker, hasn't got a clue what he's talking about. Roughie, I am truly sorry. I did not see St Mirren defeating Rangers. How do you feel about being, the top predictor at the moment?
Well, again, you know, I was seconds away from that fatal text when it was 2-1. Before Stevie Davis scored the goal, but I sort of reneged on it. I think everybody knew it was going to happen at some time. I just thought a midweek game, blustery conditions down at Paisley, you know, St Mirren have got their act together a wee bit, but Rangers were just poor. You know, they were as poor as they've been all year. They've had a fantastic year, but I'm sure the manager will be disappointed by the defence, who started leaking goals. We've seen them leaking before, but not in recent weeks or months. But he'll be disappointed, because that old, you know, haven't won a cup yet, is going to drag on a wee bit longer. And I'm sure Steven Gerrard would have wanted to get it done and dusted very quickly before the league sort of heats up. So it's a big, big disappointment for Rangers. But let's give St Mirren all the credit in the world. You know, with that squad that he's got, and a lot of young boys, you'd be lucky if they're, when we're talking about assets on the park, Rangers are talking about they've got £200 million worth of, you know, squad money in that squad. So for St Mirren to beat them, it's a tremendous achievement.
Well, that's all we've got time for on the show now, after Ruffy's answer there, which was possibly the longest one he's ever given us on the programme. But you're absolutely right, Roughie, because I watched St Mirren against Motherwell, Tam. I thought they played well, and they played some nice football, but I didn't think they were capable of stopping what was a juggernaut that is Rangers.
Yeah, it was clearly a big surprise, but I echo what Ruffy said there, and we need to give St Mirren the credit. I've been there before, Peter, as a fan of a Diddy team myself, and more often than not, if you manage to beat Celtic or Rangers, all the headlines are about one half of the Old Firm losing the game, and the credit never goes to the wee team. So, well done to St Mirren, but in the, you know, keeping with the spirit of Christmas, you can put a wee bit of positive cheer on that for the Rangers fans as well, because I think if you said to Rangers fans, if you had to lose a game before the year was out, was it going to be the Betfred Cup? Was it going to be the Europa League? Or was it going to be in the Scottish Premiership? I think as much as they want to win a trophy, and they clearly had a good chance of this one, they'd have maybe plumped for the Betfred Cup. So a wee positive spin there. And the spirit of Christmas as well for the Celtic fans, it obviously stops them thinking that Rangers are invincible and they're capable of a wee wobble, and maybe they're back in with a shout. Maybe those that have given up, maybe even some that had been doing protesting outside Celtic Park. So a long way to go. The only kind of doom and gloom, Peter, to be brutally honest, and you'll have heard my theory in this before as well, and MD that's ever listened to me bumping my gums for years knows I've had this long-held belief that whenever a team needs a result, whenever a goalie needs a clean sheet, whenever a striker needs to hit the back of the net, or indeed whenever a club or a team has to bounce back after a bad result, they always seem to play Motherwell next. And I can assure you that when the final whistle went last night in Paisley, I didn't even have to look at the fixtures list. I thought, yep, we'll be playing Rangers on Saturday. And that's exactly how it's panned out. So I'm waiting in the backlash now. And we obviously have been very, very ropey. And if I just sing a wee bit of jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way, that just beats Ruffy's longest answer that has ever been displayed on this show. So the record is now with me. I thank you.
Absolutely. It usually is broken on the programme. But nevertheless, you made a very good point there, Tam, about to St Mirren, and they deserve the credit. And I think, to be fair to Jim Goodwin, he did mention the fact that before the game he felt confident, he felt good about his team, the way they were playing, and after it, no surprise, he thinks they got what they deserved.
Extremely proud, obviously, of the effort and the overall performance of the players. And yeah, we're just delighted that we were able to pull off something that probably nobody outside our dressing room thought we could. Rangers are a fantastic team. They're in great form. Prior to tonight, I think they were 27 games unbeaten. So, you know, for us to be the team that puts a stop to that was remarkable, really. And full credit must go to the players for just their work rate, their effort and the goals that they managed to get.
And that's the key to it all, Stephen, and it will probably be the key for you on Sunday. You need everybody working tirelessly to try and shut down the key players that can cause you problems, which I think St Mirren did. And then collectively, when those little chances come along, you must take them.
Yeah, you do. Going into any game, the fundamentals of your game plan are how you can expose the opposition and how can you stop their threat. Now, the manager spoke there about Tavernier. He was being a real threat this season. And St Mirren, it was the quietest game I think I've seen Tavernier have, which, again, was the fundamentals of the game plan. And then they took their chances. And that is what I think it showed that being a cup game, that they could go and they knew what the reward was if they won the game that night. And for me, that was the most surprising thing with the Rangers' performance, was that what was at stake and how flat their performance was. When, like you said, it's been like a juggernaut flying week in, week out, game after game, constantly picking up results. But what was on top of that, you've not got anything to show for your hard work so far, whereas this was probably going to be their first opportunity to show that they are the real deal, they can get a trophy. And if you look at the teams that were left in, by far the favourites to go on and win it, and that's what surprised me the most.
Yeah, the manager, Steven Gerrard, says he's not shirking the responsibility on who's to blame.
There's a lot of things that we need to discuss and improve on, of course, but in terms of the responsibility of the results, that lies with me. I'll take that one, because the players have been absolutely magnificent from the first day of pre-season, and I don't think it's fair to point any fingers or criticise anyone. So I picked this squad, this team, the tactics, the people who come started, the people who come into the game. So the responsibility of the results should go for me.
Well, he's taking it on the chin, Roughie. I thought when Stephen Davis equalised, I thought they would go on and win. I don't know about you, yeah. But even at that point, even when they were not at it, as their manager said.
No, I think the St Mirren boys as well thought that as well. When the ball hit the back of the net, you could see them all with their hands in their head. You know, they knew what usually happens in these circumstances. Rangers just wanted to get on with it. With another 30 minutes, you probably would have said they would have been favourites. But again, let's not take it away from them. You know, I thought the young players that have come in when given the chance by Jim Goodwin, you know, have done particularly well. And Steven Gerrard's right, you know, he maybe underestimated a wee bit. He left four of the top players sitting on the bench thinking that would be enough. So, yeah, that would be going through his mind. Should he have just went for it? Because as Stevie said, if they'd won that one, they would be big favourites to have went on and won it. But it wasn't to be. Can you enlighten us, Peter, why Jim Goodwin gets sent off?
Yes, he was overzealous in his celebration. Whatever, it may well have been a gesture. Or something that, you know, I don't know if it was something he said, but he certainly wasn't too happy with being sent to the stand for that. That's an absolute stonewall certainty. But then again, listen, I mean, Jose Mourinho ran down the full side of Old Trafford, Tam, to celebrate. I've seen managers, you know, celebrate. If we're starting to send them to the stand for that, the game's a bogey.
Yeah, he said it was a gesture, Peter. I believe it was indeed a gesture. I don't know then if that meant it was aimed at the Rangers dugout. Maybe they'd been a wee touch exuberant, quite rightly, after getting equaliser when it looked as if they were going to be knocked out. But you're right, and maybe it's just a case, Peter, that a lot of these things really, really get picked up on when there's no fans inside the ground to maybe distract the four officials who are still there. But you know, I can assure you that, you know, I'm amazed we're even talking about that tonight. Seems so trivial in the whole scheme of things, you know, and I'm sure Jim Goodwin won't be bothering his backside about it. I think the only folk we should really sympathise with tonight, perhaps, Peter, are the Premier Sports guys, who were maybe hoping to have Celtic and Rangers featuring in this competition in the semi-finals. They clearly are the only two clubs that they are interested in putting on the telly. And I would just like them to be good about it now, if you like. And, you know, Chris Sutton's got enough money in his back pocket. So has Mr. McCoist. I'm not wanting to see anybody done out of a gig, but I would hope that for the semis and the final, they would bring in some appropriate pundits for those games who reflect the teams that are in the semis and the finals. Maybe show a wee bit of imagination there and a wee nod to the teams that have done well to get into this stage.
Well, I never thought I'd say this, but I very rarely, and I'm guilty of it sometimes, but I very rarely leave myself open to criticising or commenting on other broadcasters and what they should do as far as getting pundits on for the semi-finals or the finals. So, I mean, it's entirely up to them what they do on it. I know one thing, that the whole punditry thing has exploded in such a way that it's gift-tastic. I don't know if you know, Roughie, what a gif is, but you know, as Tam will tell you, when the pundits are on, the reaction to defeats or victories now, they're recording them, turning them into gifs, and having all sorts of fun with it. I mean, even on our Facebook page here, I wouldn't read them all out, Tam, because they're absolutely, I mean, they're leathering each other. They're not bothering about what we are talking about. They're just leathering each other about, you know, going for 55, trophyless Steve, you name it, it's all there. I mean, it's just like a barn fight. Nobody really cares in social media about anything that's
absolutely
said, other than let's hammer our pals, which isn't good fun, providing you're not abusive on it. But
the vast majority of them that I saw today, Peter, and he actually enjoys them, he loves them, he sent me a couple himself, or Chris Boyd. A lot of Celtic fans were saying last night the search was going on for Chris Boyd's spectacular new teeth, which he's normally been this, so far this season, only too happy to show to the camera. But he was a wee bit scowly. Face was tripping him last night. But there's loads of him, but he can have a laugh about that as well. And Ruffy's never heard of a gif. I know that. He's heard of a gilf. But I believe that is something quite different.
Or a milf.
Yeah. I have to say, no, knowing him as I do, a MILF is probably more straight to the point. Although I do agree with you, Tam. One of the best gifts I did see today was the little statement under it that says the Premier Sports Management Team, when they realise there's no Celtic or Rangers, and you see one of them getting up off the table and just opens the window and jumps out of the 54th flat.
You know, I would seriously hope they could take that in the chin as well, because the bottom line is they kind of put all their eggs in one basket when they get involved in the game. It was Celtic and Rangers. They were going for the audience, right? And Peter, guys like me and you have been involved in the media for years. We know exactly how it works, you know. So, you know, whether you've been involved in radio, telly, newspapers, you're always going with the audience. That's the way it works. That's what Premier Sports did. But I'm only saying that if, in behalf of the St Johnstone, the Hibs fans, the Livingston fans and the St Mirren fans, if they are going to watch, they'll not be able to go to these games, of course, right? We're almost certain they won't be able to go to the games. They may be watching them on the telly. They would love to see one of their ex-players, one of their legends, getting wheeched out in front of the cameras for Premier Sports. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, oh yeah, listen, you're 100% correct on it, Tam. It's one of those situations where you want to see an old legend talking about the club. Interestingly enough, you talked there about the teams who've made it to the semi-final. St Mirren now have a situation where they are at Hampden, yes, but one game away from the final. And Jim Goodwin, you wouldn't blame him, he's still feeling confident they can get there.
Listen, delighted, yeah. Livingston are a good side. We've beaten them twice already this season in the league, but look, every single team that's left in the competition, all four of us will genuinely believe we're capable of winning it. So there are no, we knew there wasn't going to be an easy draw, and but we're delighted with it. I genuinely couldn't have cared who we got, to be honest, but Livingston will be a tough, tough game, but a great opportunity for us to try and get to a final.
Is it fair to say now, suddenly, Roughie, your old team are the favourites to win this?
I think they would be the favourites, yeah, but Jim Goodwin's quite right. You know, I think all the teams that are left would expect on a given day, if things go well for them, they could win and get there. And what an occasion it's going to be for any of them who get there. You hate to remind me when that final is. Are we a chance at any supporters getting in to see it? Is it late on? Is it still early? No, there's another disappointment. That's huge. I mean, as far as Livingston, St Johnstone and St Mirren as well, for them to get to a final and supporters not going to be allowed to see their team and celebrate whichever team wins it is a tragedy. But I suppose we just have to go on with it.
Yeah, absolutely. Stephen, as you look over the semi-final draw, is it, I mean, it'd be tough for you as a Hearts player to say it, but can you see any, Hibs red-hot favourites, out of the other three, who do you think's got the best chance of upsetting the apple cart again? Is it St Mirren? Is it Livy? Is it St Johnstone?
I think, well, I wouldn't say Hibs are the favourites because where they sit in the league and their squad and stuff like that, but like the manager said, I've seen David Martindale saying the same thing, that every team in here will fancy it. And I think you've got Livingston who have got a specific way of playing. Hibs will inevitably be the most expansive and probably create the most attacking force out of all the games. As a player in every one of the change rooms, you'll be sitting there, first of all, saying you won't get a better chance to win a trophy with the Old Firm not being there. And St Mirren, for instance, have put out Aberdeen and Rangers in the last two rounds. They'll take loads of confidence from that. But I don't think you can sit here and pick a winner. I think the big occasion as well, all these players will be going into that, won't have experienced it too much. That can have an effect on the players as well. So it will definitely be a few moments of guys who want it most and come up with the goods in the individual performances.
Yeah, of course, the other big question out of this is it's the end of that unbeaten run for Rangers. Steven Gerrard now is looking at his players and wondering, can they bounce back?
It's extremely important how we react from this. You've got two choices. You either let it linger, you feel sorry for yourself, or you react in the right way, you stand up and be counted. We'll take the criticism, we'll take what's coming our way. It'll be new because we've been on such a fantastic run. So I'll be looking around the group to see who's wanting to react in the right way and positive. We need to bounce back at the weekend.
Yeah, let's have a look at the stats now, because that's the one thing about it. It's all been positive over the last couple of months. But as you can see there, he lost the League Cup semi-final to Aberdeen, the Scottish Cup. Again, the Dons put them out. The Premiership, they finished second, 9 points behind Celtic in season 2018-19. Season 2019-20, they lost in the League Cup final. How they lost, it still bemuses me to this day. A quarterfinal defeat to Hearts, and then the Premiership, 13 points behind Celtic. And as you can see here, quarterfinal defeat to St Mirren, Scottish Cup yet to enter. But the most positive thing out of it all is quite simply, Tam, they're 13 points ahead in the league. And I think that's, I'm not trying to in any way, offer an excuse, but that's the only thing that matters to Rangers fans.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's why, as I said, I think if they take a step back, allow themselves to cool down after what was a bad result, a bad night, I do think the Rangers fans will think, right, but it was the Betfred Cup. Would maybe sooner have had that wee jolt in a competition like that, rather than losing 3 points in the Premiership where they're going so well, or indeed coming a cropper in the Europa League where on paper they seem to have a right good chance now of getting into the last 16 of that tournament if they can overcome Royal Antwerp or Belgium. So I think it's, you know, if I was a Rangers fan and I was trying to put a wee positive spin, that I would say it's maybe the kick up the backside that the players were maybe needing before they get too complacent and thinking, as Barry Ferguson last week in his newspaper calling tipped them as, thinking that they were invincible this season. Clearly, they are not. So, yeah, I think you're taking a chin. And just going back for a moment, Peter, to the sad fact that would appear that there's not going to be any fans at the semis or final of the Betfred Cup. If I could maybe echo My thoughts on the Scottish Cup final. I did mention a few weeks ago that they may have considered moving the Celtic Hearts game up to Inverness or Dingwall and playing it at one of their grounds where they could, because of the restrictions and what tier those areas are in, they could have got some semblance of a crowd. You could have got Celtic fans, diehards who are based in the Highlands. Hearts, I know there's a lot of Hearts fans up in the Highlands who follow the team week in, week out. You could have maybe got a restricted crowd at the final rather than a big, empty, soulless Hampden. For a variety of reasons, they said that they couldn't do that. But I'll chuck it in early. I wonder if it's a possibility for the Betfred Cup final, Peter. And if I were to give you a scenario, a final, let's say it was St Mirren against Livingston. You know, both teams don't have a huge support. I know they would, of course, come out for a final. Fans at every club are the same. But if you could get St Mirren against Livingston, if it was those clubs in the final, at the Caledonian Stadium in Inverness, and perhaps with several hundred fans split down the middle to cheer them on, might be a wee idea.
Yeah, a lovely sentiment there from you, Tam, but as I've been too old in the heat, as far as this is concerned, it's just a non-starter. It's lovely. I mean, I love the thought of it.
Not sure how many Livy fans stay up the bot up north.
Yeah, exactly. But the other thing about it, Stephen, is they want.
But you're, in fairness, though, Stevie, you're out of tune with clubs at Livy and that because they're in a higher tier themselves. When we want some information on the Aloes and the Queen of the Souths of this world, we will come to you. That is your forte.
Absolutely. I knew you were going to get pattern for it, but to be very honest with you, I mean, the one thing that's great about Inverness, you know, Johnny Fox is Roughie, and then if you know somebody in the queue, yeah, you get into the nightclub as well. It's just a fantastic weekend. If only we could all get up there, but I can't see it happening because, of course, everybody knows the contract with the Hampden Stadium, so it's not going to happen, and there's no point in talking about it. One thing that is good is the fact the semi-finals end of January, 23rd, 24th, and then end of February, the League Cup final. And I don't think anybody is going to be allowed in. It might be 1,000, could be 2,000. They might push it to that, but I can't see it. I'd love to see fans there. And equally so, I'd love to see fans on Sunday at the Scottish Cup final. Some people, I think, are going basically to cheer the Celtic bus, and then they'll be quickly dispersed. That's what I'm told. Green Brigade and other groups are trying to go and organise something with social distancing in mind. The police will have their work cut out there. But all I would say to you is that on Sunday at 12:30, I hope you can join us.
Come and join the football family with PLZ Soccer, where on Sunday we'll be here live from 12:30 bringing you all of the build-up to Sunday's Scottish Cup final between Celtic and Hearts. It'll be myself, Peter Martin, Darren Jackson and Alan Ruff. We'll hear from Neil Lennon, Robin Nielsen, players from both teams and much more before coming back at the full-time whistle to analyse the results, break down the game, hear from the managers again and read out your thoughts and questions. Don't forget that's on PLZ Soccer's Facebook, YouTube and Twitter, live from 12:30.
Yeah, really looking forward to that. Stephen, do you, as an older player now, do you still get excited, still a wee buzz, still a wee bit of butterflies in the stomach ahead of this one?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing's excitement. Again, the last Scottish Cup final when we played Celtic, I unfortunately missed out for injury. So that on top of it being a final, just adds to it and you want to be involved. So I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it as well, Roughie. I think it's going to be a humdinger of a game. If for anything, I mean, are Celtic back? Can Hearts cause the upset? Mm-hmm. There's all sorts of little, you know, questions that will be posed. Of course, Craig Gordon, could he be the keeper who leaves Celtic and produces an unbelievable performance on the day, Roughie?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a good game. I'd like to think Hearts are going to come out and make a game of it. I think they will. You know, they'll see at some stages where Celtic have been this season defensively. So there's no point in just sitting in there, you know, and not having a go at them. Again, Neil Lennon sort of hinted the old mob coming back in. I don't think that will happen at all. I think the boys that have come in, the Turnbulls and that, have proved that they deserve a chance. I think Scott Brown could play some stage in the game. There's no doubt about that as well. But I think if Stevie's maybe being honest, I think he would say he'd wished he'd played this game a fortnight ago rather than now, because Celtic have looked as if they've got their act together a wee bit rather than a fortnight ago. So, no, I think it's going to be an end-to-end game. And as Stevie will tell you, it's all about taking chances, you know, when they come along. But for me, you touched on it there, Craig Gordon's going to be a big player. Craig Gordon has got Hearts to that final. Again, the weekend, he's going to have to prove his worth, and I'm sure he will do. So he'll be a massive player for Hearts at the weekend.
Yeah, even Christoph Berra says he's still good enough at this point to be playing for Celtic right now.
I don't think Craig's got anything to prove. Everyone knows how good a keeper he was. He is, sorry. Celtic still know that. He could easily still be playing for Celtic now. Obviously, they decided to go a different path. I don't know what happened between them.
Yeah, I mean, you've seen him at close quarters. Has the edge gone, or has he just maintained that level of consistency, Stephen, that he's managed to do over the last few years since, of course, coming back from that horrendous injury?
Yeah, I think that is it. He's found a routine. And I would say he found that routine a couple of years ago at Celtic, where his training load is what it is, and he's there and ready at the weekend to perform. And he'd done that for Celtic a lot. Very surprising that they didn't kind of keep him on. We've got the rewards of that, because he's not only came in and performed well for us, he's got back in the national team. And he's like Alan McGregor, his quality has never wavered. He's still at the top level. And that, for us, makes us a much stronger team than we were, which is fantastic for us. But again, talking about Celtic, it's probably one of the most talked about positions in their team since the summer, when they've signed a new goalie, and all three goalies have played, and you're only coming up to halfway into the season.
Yeah, and just before I get Tam's thoughts on it as well, Stephen, I've got to ask you, Ruffy mentioned there the comments of Neil Lennon. Do you think it's a bit of a red herring from the Celtic manager talking about putting in the old guard? Do you think there'll be a few surprises in that lineup?
I think that becomes his biggest problem, is that you talk about the team's uplifting performances. That's came because three or four players have come into the team that have not played beforehand. Now, it's the kind of risk of, that's why the manager's in his position. He's got to make that call. But I think there's a few players in their team that will need to play, that are very big for them, whether they've been consistent in the last month or two. But the quality they possess, kind of, I would say, puts them in the team.
Yeah, and your old teammate, Christoph Berra, mentioned the fact that while everybody's talking about the vulnerability of Celtic, they can still cause more than a few problems.
Yeah, if you look at our past results and performances, yes, they will be vulnerable, but we're no daft. You know, Celtic, on paper, they've got a really good team. They've got players who can, if they turn up, you know, and turn it on, you know, the last two games they've won, you know, and we know that, yes, everyone thinks it's an opportunity, which it is, but on the other hand, we have played this game long enough that Celtic, they've got players who have been there, done it.
Yeah, Tam, it's one of those situations. You actually have witnessed, a Motherwell side produce an unbelievable performance on a rainy night at Hampden against Celtic. They've had two games where they've had positives out of it, but do you share the belief that, you know, they're still vulnerable, especially at the back? That's the one thing that's never gone away.
Yeah, well, if the case is true that Celtic are going to bring back the old guard, so to speak, then I would be quite happy about that if I was a Hearts fan. When you look at recent performances, Celtic have got a couple of results back when they did, of course, reshuffle the team and bring in guys like Soro and David Turnbull, who I clearly know is a very, very good player. But, you know, I just think Hearts should go and enjoy it. This is fairy tale stuff for the Jambos to even get to the final, get in there as the plucky minnows. And, you know, they're getting in good goal-scoring form, as Steven Naismith knows, having scored 6 last week against Pollock or Atherley or whoever it was. You know, it's you know, just... I would just want to go there and enjoy it. No, listen, see, all kidding aside, see when you watched the semi-final and I thought Hearts were brilliant in the semi, there's no way you would have thought that Hearts were a lower league team or anything like that. And it would be folly for Celtic to treat them that way. But you've heard me say this before, Peter, and I would certainly say it if it was Motherwell going to face Celtic at the weekend in the final. I think Hearts need to score first. If they have any chance, I think they've got to score first. Knock Celtic out their stride a wee bit, because I think if Celtic score first, I think they would maybe just get into the groove, and I think that all their worries are behind them. So Jambos need to score first for me.
Yeah, and the other key point here, Stephen, which I think obviously Ruffy knows the answer to it ahead of time, but if Hearts were to pull off the shock and defeat Celtic on Sunday in the Scottish Cup final and you win the Cup, do you expect at that point, before you get to the dressing room, a vote to be held and then the Cup is taken away from you?
It wouldn't surprise me. It would not surprise me one bit.
I mean, there's more to be a... Is there a WhatsApp group set up, Ruffy? Is there anything ahead of time?
Remember now, if he's won...
That club's had a boot where it...
No. If they win it, we have to get the trophy for 6 months and then we'll get you back again.
Absolutely.
Peter, seriously, can you imagine the sorry sight if Hearts win of the bus... The busking Princes Street in Edinburgh with the players on top of the bus, masks on, sitting 2 meters apart in a seat. It would be the flattest celebration you've ever seen. Incidentally, point of order, bearing in mind that this is, if you like, last year's or last season's Scottish Cup final, if Hearts win on Sunday, do they go straight in to the last 32 of the Europa League?
Well, there's a great point on it, Tam. I mean, it's just absolutely ridiculous the way you have to work out all the permutations. Yeah. But on the point that you made there about everybody socially distancing, I mean, the absolutely... Well, it's just gut-wrenching. If you were to win it on Sunday, Stephen, there's no celebration in front of fans, and there's certainly no bus parade.
No, there's not. And that, take your weekly football, when we say it all the time, the biggest disappointment now is no crowds can enjoy any of these games. On top of that, a cup final where they don't come around that often, and you win it and the celebrations are either, you could sit and say, put on hold until the time that you can have it, but that is not the same. I've experienced winning trophies and them moments straight after, and that night are what I spoke about earlier, like some of the best memories you'll make in football.
Yeah, would it be more special than any other cup final because of what's at stake as far as stopping Celtic potentially winning a quadruple, treble, or 12th consecutive trophy? Does that give it an added little edge for you?
If I'm honest, no, really. I think the biggest thing for me is just wanting to win. As soon as you've got that thing in sight of getting a trophy, winning the title, that's what drives me the most. I think that's what I'll be thinking on Sunday before the game when it comes round to it, and hopefully I can do that. The only thing that's slightly different for myself personally is that I'll be the captain, which I'm pretty sure, or at the moment, is a nice feeling, knowing that I'll lead the team out, but it'll be extra special if we can win it.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, as far as, I've just got one wee quick question. I know Ruffy's got his sports room with all the pictures up there and it's all looking great, Stephen. First of all, to your left-hand side there, is that a golden boot? And if so, when did you get it?
Yeah, in the youth team at Kilmarnock, when you were first went full-time, there was a tournament in Ireland, the Milk Cup, sponsored by Adidas, so... If you were the top goal scorer on the tournament, you got the trophy, and me and another striker in the youth team at Kilmarnock both won it that year. So you get a proper Adidas golden boot at the time, which was nice.
Yeah, absolutely. A bit worried, Tam. Not too many photographs on that huge black wall behind him. I mean, I think he needs to put a bit more thought into it. I mean, four wee piddly photographs, a ball, and then nothing. I mean, if I could give him some... Roughie, do you think I could give him some decorating plans on how to decorate your rooms in your house? Yeah.
Just waiting a couple of their legend pictures you've got that you're going to pass on for Christmas.
Stephen, I would treat it, Stephen, as extra incentive for this Sunday coming, and think you all the newspaper cuttings, the photographs, everything that you could have framed up in that wall with you scoring the winner for Hearts in the Scottish Cup final. That should spur you on.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, let's not forget, Ruffy, obviously from Celtic, will be doing the press conference tomorrow. All the talk has been about Rangers over the last couple of months, pressure on the Celtic manager, people calling for his head. We thought it was time to go with 2 wins in 12. You didn't. You obviously wanted Neil Lennon to be given longer. In fact, I think to the Old Firm game was what you mentioned on this programme. And you've been vindicated. The board agree with you. They're giving him as much time as possible, and this time to obviously get them over the line with something historically that I don't think will ever be repeated.
No, I don't think it will. But I think Neil Lennon is sensible enough to know that a defeat would bring everything back into stage again. It's something that will be in the back of his mind that to spur them on to win that game, because the doubters are still there. And a lot of them haven't been convinced. And as we said on the show, the only way you convince them is to win games. So that's what he has to do. And that will be the main agenda, I would like to think, for the most of the players who are picked to play that game. Since Stevie's picked himself for the Hearts team, it remains to be seen who else is playing for Celtic, you know. But it's good to pick yourself and give yourself the captain's armband, you know, 3 days before the game. That's fantastic.
Can I a couple of points, Peter? First up, because we brushed over it earlier, I think you were saying how there are fans who are going to go to Hampden on Saturday to applaud the Celtic team bus. First up, I think a lovely gesture by the Rangers supporters. But the other question that I was wanting to put this time to Stevie Naismith, and I would like an honest answer, is Hearts player, perhaps Hearts captain, Stephen Naismith, who would you prefer to see in Celtic's lineup on Sunday, David Turnbull or Scott Brown? Tell the truth.
I don't think that's a streak. That's not a comparison. I think it's more David Turnbull.
What, comparing you to? You mean a quick comparison? Comparing you to a shite bag right there now.
Tumbles came in the team and played more advanced. So I don't think that is a comparison. I think they both could play.
Yeah.
That's Stephen Naismith, MP for Stewarton. refuses to answer the question.
I understand where you're coming from. I don't think it's a fair comparison on the basis of what they're going to contribute and where they're going to play. I mean, even at that, you could take it a stage further. Some people are looking and thinking, will Ryan Christie start? I think he's a stonewaller to come back in and start, Ruffy.
Yeah, but I mean, that's where Celtic are just now. The players that have come in have made it very difficult for Neil Lennon, but Christie has been a main player, as McGregor has as well, and then you've got Turnbull. So and I think that's a decent question for Tam. You know, I'll answer it if Stevie doesn't. I think Turnbull's got to play. No disrespect to Scott Brown. He's not at the forum where he was. We all know he can influence a game. But I think the players have come in, have justified that Celtic at this moment in time have got more energy with these players coming in because they've got something to prove. But I still say Scott Brown will have something to play in that one. But for me, Turnbull's got to play.
Well, interestingly enough, with that in mind, I think Scott Brown and Turnbull will play. There you go. I think Scott Brown will lead the team out, and I think Turnbull will play in it as well. I think Christie will be there and McGregor. I mean, you know, take it from it what you will. It's going to be interesting to see his team selection. He'll certainly surprise a few people if he puts in the three players. I even think Tam Connor Hazard will play in goal.
Okay, okay. I think in terms of personnel, though, if I can flip it back to the fans, I was actually going to be a bit melancholic thinking about it here, because ordinarily, on an occasion like this, correct me if I'm wrong, maybe they have done this, but Gorgie Road and up Dalry Road, they would maybe even have been a wee bit of bunting out the new ahead of a cup final. You would have had the Bakers in the classic hanging some of the icing on the cakes and maroon and all that. And I think just because of this COVID and the fans missing out, Peter, I've never known a mere low-key build-up to what is the Scottish Cup final. We know it's not going to be taking place in a, you know, traditionally glorious sunny afternoon in May. We know it's not even on a Saturday. It's going to be the Sunday afternoon. But it's an absolute killer that fans, if there's one thing you want to see your team playing in, it's a Scottish Cup final. And for the Hearts and indeed the Celtic fans, who can't he do it? It's an absolute choker. Can't even sit in the pub, which would have been a good second best. Can't even sit in the pub watching it with your mates and having a drink and all that, you know. It's a real, I just hope the game can make up for it, Peter. I hope both Celtic and Hearts put on an absolute classic, just to give everybody a wee lift.
Yeah, I just wonder, Ruffy, we've got a spare tenner. Are we going to put a fiver each on Naismith to score from outside the penalty box? Because apparently that's the norm at the moment.
Well, I'm sure he'd love that. To score a kind of goal like that in a cup final would just be fantastic, and especially if it's the winning goal. But no, I'll keep my money in the pocket.
Yeah. Oh, is that? Okay. Well, I'll tell you what, Ruffy, I'll spend your fiver as well. I'll go Naismith to score outside the box and a red card. There you are. We're bound to get something out of that, Tam. I mean, that's an absolute belter, you know?
Yeah, that.
You cover your bet.
Well, that is, of course, if the game goes ahead, because I noticed in your preview, Peter, that you've got Darren Jackson roped in for your special programme. And we all know what happens when you get Darren Jackson roped in for your specials, as you did for the Champions League final earlier this year. So he could be a jinx. He could be a jinx. This game might get abandoned on Sunday. I would hunt him then.
Yeah, absolutely. But I completely and utterly forgot all about that Man City Real Madrid game. Well done, Tam, for remembering it. Listen, thanks to so many people for mentioning who they think. And Scott Carrick has just sent a message: Duffy will flatten Naismith. Well, there's the first penalty. But other than that, I think a lot of people have got good fun ahead of it, and it's going to be, we hope, a great game with lots of goals. Fingers crossed. Couple of things I want to get your thoughts on, guys. Tam, something that's been ongoing. Ruffy will have a thought on it, Stevie as well. I think the government, the SPFL are going to enlighten everyone of how much money the clubs are going to get from that kitty. Some of the clubs in the lower leagues will be able to get it as a grant. Some of the clubs in the Premiership can take it as a loan. But the worrying aspect of this, Tam, is something we've been bleating on about for more than a few months. With no fans, clubs, some of them, are suggesting they could be going to the wall, you know, Christmas, possibly beyond, because of the lack of funds.
Yeah, I would urge the Scottish Government to try and get that money across to the clubs as soon as possible. I mean, there's a lot of chat now, Peter, political chat. I know this is not a political programme, but there's been a lot of talk about how the £500 bonus that was going to NHS workers, very deservedly so, it might not actually materialise into the new year. Maybe even a good few weeks into New Year, and of course it's going to be taxed, etc., etc. Might only be 300 odd quid, you know. And by the same token, I would hope that we could get the money out a bit quicker to the football clubs, because they've not made any bones about it. They've been quite open. Greenock Morton, a famous name in Scottish football. There's all sorts of stories coming out of there about how David Hopkin was even helping to pay the players' wages before he resigned. They're clearly struggling down there. There has been no money in via the gate. And you could say, well, they've already uptaken their season tickets, so there wouldn't have been any extra money. But there's always more money if you've got the turnstiles open for floating supporters who come along. If the team's put together some good results, you've got that wee bit of hospitality that every club does so well, and they can always make a copper coin from that. But there's been nothing, absolute zip. So it's a worrying time. So if that grant money is there for clubs like Morton and other clubs in their position, then please, 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 if anybody's tuned in here, Joe Fitzpatrick or MDLs for the Scottish Government, get the money to the clubs now. It might just save them.
Yeah, on that point, Roughie, even with a situation like Morton, I mean, I was astounded by the fact that David Hopkin, obviously the suggestion is that he'd, you know, he looked at the budget cuts and thought, no, I can't stay on. I couldn't do the job under those circumstances. We learn now that he's been putting his hand in his pocket. He's even been getting breakfast and lunch for some of the staff. That's a worrying situation. Now, I know previously Douglas Ray, who was the old chairman, loved that club and put his hand in his pocket on more than a few occasions. Crawford, we know well, maybe has taken a different attitude to how Morton continue as a club before he hands it over to the fans.
Yeah, I'd like to believe that he does want to hand over to the fans, but there's obviously rules and regulations of how he's going to hand it over. His family, as you rightly said, have put millions and millions of pounds into that. We saw Dave King try to claw some of the money that he's put into his club, so why shouldn't they try and get something back? But it's going to be a difficult time for everybody. And I have to say, Peter, although we want, and Tam's talking about, we want this grant, you know, handed out as quick as possible, there's going to be a massive fallout of how this is going to be divvied up. Some clubs are going to get a lot more than others. You know, we've seen that the clubs in the lower divisions are in a worse state than some others. So it's going to be interesting who decides who gets what, you know, because every club needs every penny. I wouldn't like to think the big clubs are going to get any much more than the smaller clubs. I saw the divvy of, you know, the SFA money being handed out, and teams in the Championship were getting something like 60, 70, 80,000. Clubs down in the second division were getting 2,000. Now, that to me isn't a fair dividend in the state of where football is just now. That's just my opinion. I just think it, when it gets handed out, everybody should get an equal share.
Well, that's an interesting take on it, Roughie. The one thing that I think you've highlighted there, which I think is going to be really difficult, is it a panel of people who suddenly turn around, Tam, and decide this club's need is greater than that club's need, so we're going to give them 10,000 or them, you know, 100,000 in this club, maybe only 10. That's going to be a difficult one. I can understand where Ruffy's coming from with the major arguments that are going to unfold. But right across the board, an equal amount of money, again, is that the best way to approach it?
Yeah, well, you know, Peter, I've got absolutely no idea the nuts and bolts of it. I was under the impression that with any sort of grant, it's something that you always have to apply for. And if the individual clubs had to apply for the grant money, then they would make their circumstances crystal clear. I'm just astonished. I mean, when you look at it now, that's March. The last time we had any fans inside Scottish football grounds, the bills have to be paid. And I'm astonished that actually there's not been a single club yet that has chucked in the keys, and I'm terrified just how close some of them may be. But you know, this isn't the money that Morton or any other clubs are looking for to, you know, to reinvest in players or anything. I think we're at a stage now we're talking about money being brought in just to keep the lights on, you know, and keep paying a skeleton staff at the club so they can still pick up the phone and try to have the club operating as normally as possible. But it's grim. And in the short term, at least, you think it's only going to get worse. But I would just echo that point then. If there is grant money there, then the Scottish Government, please, please get it out pronto.
Yeah, and just on that point, and this is a difficult one for yourself, Stephen, but what we can't forget is the football, although we think it's special, all of these clubs operate as a business. And they will have to plead their case accordingly. That's why I think the potential for Roughie saying it should be a blanket amount of money, straight 10 grand to you, 10 grand to you, everybody gets the same. I don't think it works that way. That would be you treating football as a special case.
Peter, I don't think it will be worked that way. It'll work the way the self-employment thing is. Whatever you've put in as your
But the running costs of the club.
But why should some clubs suffer for other clubs who haven't looked after their budget and budgeted accordingly? Some teams have thrown money at it and got themselves into all sorts of debt. So why should they get preference to other clubs who have looked after their budget and money?
No.
I think it's more likely to be on the running costs of the actual business, not so much maybe a player's budget or whatever like that. The actual running costs of a club, an SPL club, say a top six club, their staff per year is much greater than St Mirren or a Livingston in terms of what they generate as a business. Not so much in terms of throwing money here, there and everywhere, but everything out with the football side of it, the marketing, their hospitality. That is what it will inevitably come down to, a percentage of your running costs, rather than just saying, right, we've got a pot of this, we're going to give it to everybody the same.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, with that in mind, I think Tam's right. Get it out now, yes, by all means, get it out. But it's still going to operate as a business. I think I understand where you're coming from, Roughie, because some clubs will be, applying for money and they've been buying players when they shouldn't have, and they've been, you know, obviously in some view not handling their business properly. But that's the same out in the big bad world as well. Lots of people are.
That's maybe why it's taking so long. Yeah, because it'll be looking back at your accounts over the previous years.
Yeah, lots of people apply for things and people go, why are you getting that money? I mean, I know there's a lot of big blue chip companies, Tam, who've actually said, look, we applied for bounce back loans or loans from the government or various other things that we got during this period of 9 months, and they've agreed to hand the money back.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a strange one. We should leave it, I think, to the experts and to the financial people at every club. The other thing that I would say, and it's maybe something that the fans could have done, Peter, you know, a lot of clubs, including Moan, Motherwell, we've always had the early bird scheme with the season ticket when they go on sale. And normally, I think in Motherwell, if you bought your season ticket, for example, in the month of June, you traditionally get, I think, 5 or 10% off the price. I wonder if clubs, if we can take it that the start of next season, that for August 2021, you know, fingers crossed, the world will be a different place. We'll be back to normal. Fans will be inside the grounds, etc., etc. I wonder if the clubs should think right down the divisions about an early bird scheme and making it a really early bird scheme, and even making season tickets available to fans, to the diehards who have got their club in their heart. Bring out the season tickets for next year from January even. And for the fans that can't afford that, they could maybe, you know, take the plunge a lot earlier than they usually would, because I think that cash should be a godsend to absolutely every club. And you know what? There's so many fans out there, and I would include myself in that, Peter. When you've had a season ticket at your club as long as I've had, I'm into my 42nd year or whatever it will be next season at Motherwell. The season ticket isn't the be end all, isn't it, about this book or this card that allows you to get into the games. It's your way of putting a wee something into the club that you love. And I bet that even if there was not 100% certainty of fans being back in August 2021, if there still was, you know, the possibility of having to watch games on laptops and iPads when you get the email for your club to watch the stream, I bet there are loads of fans out there, and I'll include myself in that, who would still be in jail for enough to put that few hundred quid into your club. I definitely think it's worth considering.
Yeah, listen, it's a way of life for so many people. All we need to hope is that maybe James Anderson has earned quite a few shekels on the interest on his billions, Nazy, and the old Hearts fan bails everybody out like he's done for the last few months. He's been an absolute godsend, let me tell you. Anyway, a couple of things before we go. Roughie, give us your prediction for Sunday.
Sunday, I've already said that Craig Gordon will play a big, big part in this game, but I do think Celtic have got the firepower to win this 2-0.
Okay, and because Roughie is in red hot form, we're just writing this down now. People are rushing out to the bookies as we speak. He's in blistering form. There's no point in asking Stevie Naismith. He's the captain. He's hoping he's going to be lifting that Scottish Cup up on Sunday. Dreams of celebrating with his mates. And of course, we are looking at it, Tam, and we've got to give a prediction. I think it's going to be a really, really tight game. And I think... I think Celtic will edge it 2-1. What about you?
I've got a feeling in my water about this one, Peter. Craig Gordon, I can just visualise him being the story of this game. You mentioned it earlier. So because of that, I'm not going to give you a scoreline prediction. I'm just going to say that it will go to penalties. It will go to penalties and Hearts will win the cup on Sunday.
Oh, there you are. Could your nerves take penalties? Have you practised them, Stevie?
To be fair, a few of the boys practice them all the time, so I'd be comfortable with that.
Oh, yeah, captain absolutely. Takes the first turn.
Well, I was going to say, if you get any bottles.
Oh, the last one, no. The last one.
Oh, what, oh just, yeah.
Take the glory.
Yeah, just so you, take the glory. You can be the one. Yeah, I've met a few captains like that.
Did Ronaldo not do that in a big cup final, but the time it came to him, it was late. Done. It was done.
Yeah, exactly.
Fact, it might have done that.
Just out of curiosity, do you practice? You're saying a lot of the boys have been practicing. Have you practiced?
Aye, I have a few.
Yeah, okay. Which way do you go?
To be fair, it's never the same, though. It's never the same. Over the bar.
Brilliant. Listen, quick mention on the games last night. Liverpool, top of the league, Roughie. After last night, a last-minute winner, there was the Premier League for you. You've got Aston Villa, Burnley, or Sheffield United, Manchester United tonight. Everton with the win. Leeds United thumped Newcastle. Arsenal's misery still continues. Can't buy a win at the moment. But Liverpool, they got the win over Tottenham. And it's getting interesting at the top, Roughie, isn't it?
Yeah, it certainly is, particularly in Man City, you know, firing all cylinders, and there's teams up there in that top six you wouldn't have imagined. So some of them will be looking at the Leicester City situation, but I still think the big teams will come to the fore. Personally, I thought Spurs should have got a point last night. I thought they put a lot more into the game to come away with a defeat.
Yeah, Jurgen Klopp, no surprise, he says they deserve the win.
Tough period, really tough period. Not only coming up, we went already through, and playing then a game like this tonight is absolutely exceptional. Top game, deserved 3 points against the top side, organization-wise. So difficult to play against them with the counter-attacking threat they have.
Yeah, I like Jurgen Klopp, Tam, do you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've got little regard for the English game. I don't tune into it, I don't watch it. But since he arrived in the scene, he's kind of brightened it up. Good fun in the interviews. And I put on one bet, though, last night, but I was too busy with Coronation Street, Peter. You know, I like a bet, a 0-0. I put my money last night on Fulham against Brighton, but I've still not seen the score. How did that finish?
I'm not going there. All I will say to you is we're delighted that Big Sam Allardyce is back in football. He's been appointed the West Brom manager. So a good 3 days ahead for West Brom before they start looking for another manager. That's Big Sam back in the game.
A good 3 days, Big Sam trying to get his head through his Christmas jumper. What a napper that is, eh?
Oh, absolutely. Listen, Stevie, we've got your Maestro jersey. We will get it over to you as soon as we possibly can. I can tell you, Charlie Adam, I delivered his Maestro jersey to him this morning, Roughie. He was crying when I handed it over to him. I'm not sure if it was the emotion of getting a Christmas present for me or last night's result that really put him over the edge, but he seemed all emotional when I handed it over to him, Roughie. He's happy with his. I'll get Nazy's to him and Tam's as well, and we'll get yours for Sunday for you to put on, Roughie.
Yep. That'd be great. It'd be wonderful. Hope it's the right size.
I'm not, Yeah, don't you worry about it. I've got your size. I've got you marked out for it. Listen, Stevie, the very best of luck to you. You're the captain of Hearts. If you do indeed lift the cup on Sunday, it'll be absolutely fantastic for you and the boys. You'll get a chance to party. Having lived in Edinburgh for 12 years, I know lots of my Jambo friends are hoping it's going to be a day to remember. And usually when a club wins it out with Celtic or Rangers, it's got that extra special edge to it as well, Tam. Is that fair?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's how, you know, as much as we're joking about Premier Sports, maybe no fancy in showing the semi-finals and indeed the final. What a time. The Betfred Cup for the wee clubs to get a right crack at it, a wee bit of glory without Celtic or Rangers there and fearing that they're going to get pumped. You know, it's great for them. And Hearts can go in, all joking aside with Stevie as well. You know, they are a lower league club. That's the bottom line. They're a lower league club. You're going to face Celtic, who are going for a quadruple treble. No pressure. No pressure on Hearts. Get out there and enjoy yourselves. And you're in good goal scoring form. I just hope it's a cracker.
Yeah, absolutely. Hear, hear. Anyway, on that note, I wish Tam and Stephen a very Merry Christmas. Stephen, we'll see you on Sunday as well at the game. We'll be there looking on and watching to see how you perform on the day. Let's hope it's a good Scottish Cup final to each and every one of you out there. Join us tomorrow on the programme. The build-up continues to the Scottish Cup final and, of course, the weekend's football. If you can, join us tomorrow at our usual time of around 4 o'clock. But from Roughie, Tam, Stevie and myself, Peter Martin, thank you very much for watching.
It's the perfect Christmas gift for your dad, mum, your brother, your sister, your best friend. The Legends limited edition series by sports artist Jim Scullion is available to order now. From t-shirt to canvas to prints, select your favourite legend of football. From Larson to Loudrum, Pele to Maradona, Messi or Ronaldo. Order your perfect stocking filler now by clicking on the link to own your very own limited edition legend.
Expect the best used car deals guaranteed. Visit Arnold Club.